Welcome COJ family, COJ nation, COJ partners around the world. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will, I must, and I shall rejoice and be glad in it. I'm so excited. This is our midweek time of lifting up God's name. And I don't know about you, but I look forward to the opportunity to celebrate God. As the Bible says in the Gospel of John chapter 4, in spirit and in truth. Go over to the chat box and just put spirit and truth, spirit and truth. Amen. I want to welcome you if you're with us for the first time, YouTube, Facebook, sharing with us. I want to welcome you to our midweek Bible class where we learn the things of God. And I want you to know you are our VIP tonight. And I thank you for sharing with us. And I want you to know that leading lady and myself and the members of COJ, we love you. And in order for us to appreciate you, I need you to go over to the chat box real quickly. Just put your name, your initials, tell us where you're worshiping from. And I'm going to ask the COJ family to just offer you some love to welcome you to our service tonight. And prayerfully, you'll come back and see us again in the near future. COJ, go to the chat box and just welcome our amazing VIPs on tonight. Amen. We're excited. We're starting a new study tonight in the month of February that I'm excited about because this is the year that I'm going to be teaching on the five F's. And last month we dealt with faith, and I pray you were blessed. If you missed it, I want you to go back to YouTube. So with your pen and your paper, it's worth noting. And this month, we're going to be focusing on family, And just in case there's someone who wants to become a part of COJ family, you can go to our website, cityofjoygm.org. And there's a place and a space on the first page where you can sign up if you want to become a part of our family. I will be honored to be your online pastor. The city of joy would be honored to be your minister. Jesus Christ would love to be your savior, and the Holy Ghost would love to be your comforter. It's as simple as signing up, and our awesome and amazing new members ministry will reach out to you and start a relationship in helping you to become God's choice disciple in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you got your pen? You got your pad? We're going to deal with a lot of things on tonight. After I pray, I want to talk about some challenges that I have for you as a family. That's going to be a blessing. This is a new month, a new teaching, and I would encourage you to do some things with your family on this particular month. Join me in prayer. Father, we love you. We thank you for the believers across the world. As we go into your marvelous word tonight, teach us, strengthen us, open our hearts and our minds to your word, that we can be all that you're calling for us to be. Now I pray that you move by your authority and teach us with your truth. In Jesus' matchless holy name, I pray. Somebody shout amen. Amen. You have your pad, you have your pen, you have your paper. The first thing I want you to write, I want to challenge each family to do something this particular week. We're going to do something different each week. And on this particular week, I want you to challenge your family to memorize Psalm 23. Even your younger ones in your family who's able to read, I want you to challenge them to memorize Psalms 23. And on next week, I'm going to give you two of them at a time. I want you to challenge your family to memorize and recite the 39 books in the Old Testament. It's something that you can do with your family fun. And and when you come to Bible study next week, please put in the chat box if you were able to memorize Psalms 23. And I'm excited about that. I need you to grab your Bibles. I'm going to start teaching about family. It's going to be a blessing to you, and it's going to be encouraging to you. But there are a lot of notes, a lot of scripture, and I don't want you to miss any of them. Okay? Because the family is and always will be the basic building block of society, it's important for you and I to understand If the family collapses, society collapses. That's very important. That's extremely important. Because when you read the Bible, you understand that God places a high value on the family. And what I've understood as a child of God, as a servant of God, that I want to value what God values. God, and you need to know this, is in this thing. He's into this thing we call family. It means something to God. One reason it means something to God, he designed it. Write that down. It's not your note, but it's a worth noting. He created it. And he has a plan to use family for his glory. Okay. Now, one of the challenges that we have to uncover, it's a big boulder that I want to turn over today, is that the modern world is working overtime to try to redefine the family. Overtime. The traditional concept of family that corresponds to the biblical concept of the family group that would normally comprise of a husband, a wife, and their dependent children, which would constitute a fundamental unit in the organization of society. I want you to know, ladies and gentlemen, this definition of family is under attack in the world that we live in right now. I want to share with you a quote that was written in the U.S. News and World Report May 9th, back in 1983, over 40 years ago, defining what the family will look like in 2033. On a spring afternoon, half a century from today, the Joneses are gathering to sing Happy Birthday to Junior. There's Dad and his third wife, Mom and her second husband, Junior's two half-brothers from his father's first marriage, his six stepsisters from his mother's spouse's previous union, 100-year-old great-grandpa, all of Junior's current grandparents, assorted aunts, uncle-in-laws, and step-cousins, while one robot scoops up the gift wrapping and another blows out the candle, Junior makes a wish over the cake that he wished he didn't have so many relatives. The article goes on to say that relationships then will be in a confusing tangle as a result of people living longer and changing mates to suit the season of their life. There will be serial marriages. A growing trend even now will be a normal and planned for part of adulthood. Tomorrow's children will grow up with several sets of parents and a assortment of half and step siblings. Over the next five decades, experts, and I want you to hear me good, say that society will redefine its concept of family through the pattern of divorce and remarriage. A whole network of kinship will arise. There will be a double set of grandparents, double set of aunts and uncles and brothers and sisters, as well as former in-laws and ex-spouses, all of them making up the new divorce extended family. Ladies and gentlemen, as we deal with family this particular month, I'm going to spend time letting you understand what challenges families are facing today. But we're also going to understand what was God's design and original intention for creating family. Let me start off by talking about the cultural forces that are underlining and undermining the success of the family. There's a few things, and I want you to write these down. I'm going to give you at least about five. One of the things that's hurting families more than anything today is the busyness of our lifestyles. Write that down. The busyness. We're so busy, we don't have time for each other. Fathers don't have time for the kids. Mothers don't have time for the children. Kids are too busy for family. And it's undermining the success of the family. Number two, the focus of materialism. We have become a materialistic society. So families are being hurt because we're treating things better than we're treating relationships. There's nothing wrong with the car. There's nothing wrong with the house. There's nothing wrong with certain things. But don't spend more time on non-living things than you're spending on relationships. Are you with me? The excessive divorce rate, write that down. It's affecting and it's undermining the success of the family. When families break up, it has an impact on children. Not just on children, but because we're dealing with family this month, it has an impact on the children's children. And then it has an impact on the children's children's children. Let me give you another one. We have another force that's undermining the success of the family, and it is the TV's model of family. Write this down. TV model of family. The TV's model of family. And sometimes we can get so caught up in what Hollywood depicts a family to look like. Are you with me? Because Hollywood is designed to sell shows, they're designed to get your attention, they're designed to create figments of what they desire to be real, whether it's TV shows or sitcoms, and persons who have not been trained through the scripture, they don't know what God expects of the family, nor the role of persons in the family, so they will look at something on TV and they will adapt that as their family model. And so people who are being raised by MTV and BET and CBS and Fox and NBC, their family looked more like what they see on TV than the things in the Word of God. And I'm going to deal with that a lot later, but I just want you to write down the TV model of family. And if I deal with the TV model of family, sometimes it doesn't constitute what God says about family. And then number five, the culture of comforts, because the culture we live in desires everything the easy way. And that undermines the success of the family, the culture of comforts. Write that down. I'm going to throw in one more, and then I'm going to move on. That has undermined the success of the family. And that is called the debt society. Mm-hmm. That as a family, we can become so indebted by poor choices that we become slaves to debt. So we're not able to spend time with the family because we got three jobs. We have so many financial obligations that we don't have time for each other. And the family core unit has not been able to grow because the debt society makes us a slave to debt. And it keeps us from enjoying life, enjoying one another, and building up the family. So people of God, let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And I want to read verses 1 through 5. And I'm reading from the New Living Translation. And what I want to talk about as we're dealing with family, what the Bible shared with us about the context of the last days. And I want to see if you think this sounds familiar to where we are now. Starting with verse 1, you should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times. Do you feel like the times we're living in are difficult? Verse 2, for people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. That sound like today? Verse 3. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. Verse 4. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and they will love pleasure rather than God. That sound like today? Listen to verse 5. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. And listen what Timothy says. Stay away from people like that. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're dealing with family, and I wanted to share with you that it was already written in the Word of God that in these last days we would see signs, and some of them are signs that we're seeing right now. So as it relates to the family, the question that I want to deal with first, what is the foundation for the first family? The first family will share with us what the foundation of the family is all about, and we find that in Ephesians chapter 3. Turn there. We love the Word of God in our study. If you're with us for the first time, if we go too fast, I want you to go back and go through this message and this teaching with your pad and your pen so you can grow. So we're looking at the foundation for the first family. And can I share with you? The foundation for the first family in the Bible is God Himself. Listen to this verse. For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family, highlight the word family, in heaven and earth is named. I need you to highlight that. Whole family in heaven and earth is named. God Himself is the foundation for the first family. So when we look at the first family, and some person will say, well, are we getting ready to look at Adam and Eve? No, Adam and Eve is actually the second family. The first family is found in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Because they was here before Adam and Eve. In order for Adam and Eve to get here, they had to be created. I wish I had somebody. So if you had to be created, then you were not the first family. The first family was here before we had rivers and rivulets and humans. The first family was the power of being with God, God the Father, write it down, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost that created everything. How do we understand more about the first family? Let's go to Isaiah chapter 64. And we're going to look at each individual, a part of the Godhead, to understand more about the first family. Okay? Now, we're going to start with looking at the Father. Write this down. Because the Father reveals the nature of the true fatherhood. And we find that in Isaiah 64, in verse number 8. Glory be to the name of the Lord. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are clay. Highlight that. And you our potter, and all we are the work of your hands. So when you look at the Father, the true nature of God is fatherhood. You need to write that down. This is very important. Because we're starting to understand the first family. And for you to understand family, you can't just start looking into family to what you believe it is now. we got to look at the first family to see the nature of those who was a part of the first family. So the father shows us the nature of the true fatherhood. Now, let's look at the son, because the son reveals the nature of true sonship. Write that down. The son reveals the nature of true sonship. Go to Isaiah chapter 7. Isaiah chapter 7. And we're going to look at verse 14. Amen. And verse 14 in Isaiah chapter 7 says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a what? A son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." So now we see that the son reveals the nature of true sonship. So you got a father and you have a son. I need you to stick with me, because this is very powerful through you learning and growing as it relates to family, because family matters. Okay? Let's look at the Holy Spirit, because there were three parts of the Godhead: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Now, what you need to understand is that the Holy Spirit actually reveals the feminine side of God. While all the persons of the Godhead are always referred to in the masculine gender, there is no question that the Holy Spirit bears many attributes of motherhood. Go to Genesis chapter 1. I want to show it to you in the Word of God. Genesis chapter number 1. Hallelujah. In Genesis chapter 1, what you discover, and I want to look at verse number 2, it says, "Now the earth was formless and empty, darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God," highlight Spirit of God, "was hovering over the waters." So the Holy Spirit, I need you to see the picture, brooded over the face of the earth, much like a mother hen would brood over her chickens. The earth was without form and void, but the Spirit had to get over it, over the face of the waters. So the Holy Spirit, watch this, was brooding like a mother hen over her chicks. But then the Holy Spirit is also a comforter. Go to Isaiah chapter 66. We're looking at the nature of the first family. Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit is the comforter, much like the mother who comforts her young. And Isaiah 66, verse 13, we want to read this. And listen what it says. "I will comfort you there as a child is comforted by its mother." Highlight the word comfort, and then highlight the word comforted. Again, we see the Spirit of God is actually there, and you see feminine characteristics, the care and the brooding and the comfort. But then it doesn't stop there. I want to show you what happened when Jesus was down in the pool getting baptized. Let's go to Matthew chapter 3. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 3. We're looking at the first family. You need to understand the first family. In order to get back to understanding what's expected of your family, we need to look at the first family, then we need to look at the family that he created, then we need to see what happened to cause them to miss out on the blessing or where they went wrong, so we can kind of correct some of those areas. Okay? Matthew chapter 3, verse number 16. And listen what it says. "After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him." So the Holy Spirit has always been viewed as being gentle, but yet the Holy Spirit is a part of the Godhead family. So now you see God the Father that shows the true nature of the Father. God the Son that shows the true nature of the Son. But then God the Holy Spirit that shows the nature of a carer and a comforter, one of loving attributes that we need, especially in times where we go through. Now, and to some of your dismay, so now we looked at the first family. Now let's start to look at the extended family, because the reality is Adam and Eve were extended family of the first family. Lord, I wish I had somebody tonight. So the vision for the extended family was found not in Adam or Eve. They didn't know nothing about this. It was found in the heart of the Father. Go to Genesis chapter 1. I need you to stick with me tonight, because we're going to get in some deep stuff on next week and the week after this month. But you have to get a foundation to be able to handle what God is trying to tell us about our families and what we need to do to secure our families and to strengthen them in the things of God. Okay? Genesis chapter number 1. Amen. I love to see you reading your Bible. Chapter number 1. Let's look at verse 26. It says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So now we're discovering something about God. Verse 27. So God created man in his own image. Man didn't create God. God created man. I'm going to say it one more time. Man didn't create God. God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Verse 28, God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number." Now, for the first time, the Bible says that God declared it is not good for man to be alone. And we see that in Genesis 2 and 18, but we got to understand something, that it was God talking to Adam. So God had in his desire for an extended relationship. Why did God desire that Adam not be alone? Remember, we want to talk about family. So we got to go back to see the original design for the first family. But then we got to start to analyze and understand the extended family of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. So now we're looking for the reason why God would create Adam and Eve. We can't try to assume why he created them. We got to look in the Bible to see why he created them. Now, I'm going to give you about four or five things that I want you to write down, because when he created Adam and Eve, one of the reasons is because he desired offspring in his image. Write that down. He just didn't create them just to create them. He created them in his own image. Okay? Family. To reflect him, not them. Number two, he created family because he desired his offspring to reproduce, to fill up the earth. Okay. Number three, he created family because it was his desire that his offspring would reach a place of maturity to reflect his character and nature. So he didn't create family just to be family. He created family so that families would reflect God's character and God's nature. And so even when they reproduced, he expected them to reproduce that would fill up the earth. Stick with me. I need you to be writing these down. Number four, God desired to have an intimate relationship and communion with his offspring. So he didn't create Adam and Eve to exist without having a relationship with him. He created them so they would have a relationship with him. Are you sticking with me here? So the original family was not designed to be independent from God. Your family is not designed to exist without connecting with God, talking to God, seeking God. The original design of the first extended family was to stay in communion with God. But then let's go deeper. His desire also was that his offspring would enter into a God-like function, because when you read Genesis, he says, I'm expecting what I created and the first extended family to rule and reign just like I do. And they would rule on earth just like I rule. They would have dominion on earth just like I do. That they would not live being subjected to things on earth, but things on earth would be subjected. I wish I had somebody who was there, because if you're with me tonight, you would see that some of the struggles in families is that we're not assuming the God-given purpose of the extended family. And when we get out of God's purpose for the family, that's when we start to deal with the struggles of what we're dealing with now. I want to give you one more. God's desire that his offspring would eventually qualify as a bride for the eternal Son of God. That God expects families to exemplify holiness, righteousness, walking in the things of God, because he has a greater picture, which is when his son Jesus comes back, that his bride, which is also called the church, those people who love God and committed to God and blood-bought believers, that they would be prepared when God sends his son back for the world. So what is the good biblical...
Thanks for joining us for this week's Bible study on Family Matters. Join us next week as we continue our discussion and teaching on Family Matters.
Hey, before you leave this page, make sure you hit the thumbs up. Share this content with your family and friends or to your social media platforms, and subscribe to our channel for up-to-date content from the City of Joy Nation.